Already in the 80s, early 80s, he was starting to change and looking for more interesting stories. You can cut me off or contradict me at any time. And he really did a terrific series with The Jungle Book, and a recent project picks up on that, with some quite lean and elegant art where Craig starts to limit the amount of words and uses an elegant pictorial language. In this case, with Mowgli and creating movement with vertical panels, as you see there in the right corner, interacting in various ways, already moving his panels, overlapping his panels, and you notice no word balloons, okay, in there. Going back to what did Strauss say about always trying to work the lyrics with the instrumentation. Okay, something like that. And then going through, it's really this kind of lyrical power. And then right there, as he's coming down to the end, some words to highlight to the narrative. But the narrative is going here in the pictures. What, this is 1984?
Spring Running. You've got me there. Let's see. I know, I think it's into the 90s at this point. Yeah.
But by this time already, Craig has established himself probably as the best storyteller in pictures in all of comics. And I'm not exaggerating here. It's really quite powerful. He stays, by the way, once in a while will come in and do what we would call a traditional comic character. Here we have Conan, and this is the Jewels of
Gwalior.
And this had some particular importance for you, right, or interest?
Well, he mentioned Barry Windsor Smith. These are from the tales of Robert E. Howard, who was the original Conan author. And Barry did one called Red Nails in around 1973. Barry's only 4 years older than me, but he was like the old man of the sea when I was starting out. He had really reached a peak of work, and everyone, this is a very famous piece of work he did called Red Nails, and it's from a Robert E. Howard story. Well, the Jewels of Gwalior in the chronology of Howard's stories is basically the morning after that story. So his art at that time was very influential on me, and also his influence by the Pre-Raphaelites, which opened up that whole 19th century era of art. So that took me over in that direction. So some 25 years later, this was my sort of homage and response to that early influence. When they asked me, an editor at Dark Horse, if I would do a Conan story, I said yes, I want to do the one immediately after Red Nails. So that's how that happened.
And why don't you just continue and explain how you laid out this page, because this is a perfect example how he tells a story.
Well, sometimes it's very simple of just trying to lay the groundwork for the relations of the characters in the story. When you're reading the story, the author is telling you, setting up the dynamics of this conflict, who's on this side and this kingdom, all the politics of this. And sometimes it can be hard to retain all that information, or also to stage it in a way. I mean, visually, what is happening? Nothing is happening. There's no conversation that you can stage in an interesting way. There's no action. It's sort of like The Scarlet Letter, which I also adapted. Talking about Hester Prynne's relation to the society she was living in. Well, what do you show? You know, you have to come up with some sort of visual structure. In this sense, it's something just as simple as showing on that top panel Conan on the far left, and the characters that he's sort of in opposition to on the other side. So you just do this simple visualization of these opposing forces literally on either side of the divide, and the caption box in between separating them, that it explains their relation. It says he's working out this whole strategy, and with positive evidence of the treasure's reality, the kings of Zimbabwe would move, Punt would be invaded simultaneously. Then when both Punt and Kishan were exhausted from the struggle, the Zimbabweans would crush both races and take the treasure by force. but there was always another possibility. So when you're just reading that, he's just saying, he's explaining the politics, but you can use the visuals to clearly set up that dynamic. And you can do it sometimes in very simple ways. You don't have to draw an entire force, every single character. You can do it using a silhouette and a color silhouette in the foreground to see this defeated army and the advancing army, done very, very simply, but just as a mass of characters moving forward. The Zimbabweans would crush both races, so they're moving in while all these characters have killed each other. The third party now moves in, and it says, and take the treasure by force. So we come in for after this sort of epic scale, you come into something very intimate, the hands going into the casket with the treasure in it. And it says, but there was always another possibility. If Thutmeri could get his hands on the hoard, it would be characteristic of the man to cheat his employer, steal the jewels for himself, and decamp, leaving the Zimbabwean emissaries holding the sack. So you literally see the empty casket, the foot going out. You don't have to show the entire figure, just a foot leaving the scene. He's already passed out of the scene. I mean, you're just seeing the very end, tail end of him leaving, and then you see the Zimbabwean emissaries on the defensive as these weapons, from every direction, pointing in towards them. So if you took that little piece of prose by itself, it'll explain everything. But if you have visuals, you can make an image in the viewer, reader's eyes that just clarifies their relations.
And we will see those spears again. And then, of course, Craig has had a long and fruitful relationship with Neil Gaiman, beginning about 20 years ago with The Sandman, and especially this Sandman number 50, Ramadan, quite a favorite of mine given its subject matter. But also, this is one of the great award-winning, this Eisner Award-winning comic. This is one of the greats out of The Sandman. Again, of using certain styles and techniques to create an atmosphere. And this isn't an Orientalist one so much as world of fantasy. And of course, when you think about the Arabian Nights, that's already a fantasy of its own. Also, too, in the Dream Hunters, this wonderful story that takes place in Japan, where Craig meticulously, how many books did you read for this?
I mean, well, I had bought a stack of books on Japanese art, just as I had books on Islamic art when I was doing the Ramadan issue. So you try to adapt in a certain way without aping it, trying to look exactly like that art, but certain features of it. And this is another example of, this is a fox. It's a love story between a monk and a fox, and the fox takes human form. But she always has this sort of end, this sort of tail that shows that she is a fox. And she's working on this horrible man that has hurt the monk, and she's getting him to give over all of his power. He's a magician himself. And there's one more thing, and that is your magic. How can I be your love and your wife if I knew you commanded Tengu and Oni, and that in your scrolls you had the knowledge to change me into a bird if I displeased you? Now, this was a prose piece that Neil wrote, not as a comic, but as simply a prose piece. So this is what this character says at that point. That's her piece of conversation. They gave me the opportunity to put her sort of in the center at the bottom, and as she mentions Tengu and Oni, show the Tengu and Oni. It's a great visual possibility. So they're all surrounding her, and this is an advantage of the age of using computer coloring. For years I did all my coloring on the originals or photostats, and you were sort of stuck with that black line. This was all done in black, in ink, but I can tell the colorist I work with, knock that out as a color because they're a fantasy, you know, that they aren't really there. And then you get to work the composition in which that word balloon is centered right in the middle of the picture as all of this writhes around it, even coming down to this point where these little tails pick up on and lead your eye into her and into this. So you make this swirling thing that you can get all this detail, and yet by isolating her, only connecting it with this one little tail, so that you are focused on her in the midst of all of this phantasmagoria.
And then, of course, we have the most recent Neil Gaiman, Kurt Russell collaboration, the Graveyard Book. This won the Newbery Award, the original.
The novel.
And now Craig is illustrating it in two parts and organizing the art, drawing some of it himself. And in a sense, this is a return to the Jungle Book.
Right. The Jungle Book has seemed to have haunted me all through my career. Around 1970 at Marvel Comics, they were proposing to do a book, a series, adapting the Jungle Book stories, and then they would spin off new stories. They did two issues, adapting the first four of the Mowgli stories, and then put it on the shelf for whatever reason. It sat in a drawer until the mid-80s, when they pulled it out for a special magazine they had, and it was another artist who drew it, Gil Kane. And they asked me to ink these four eight-page chapters, which I did. And after we finished that, the writer who was doing the final script said, we should do one together. So we did the King's Ankus, the fifth Mowgli story. And we proposed it for Marvel's, what was the name of their magazine? Marvel, not Fanfare, the Epic, their Epic magazine. And they said, no, we're doing more science fiction and sword and sorcery, and a Jungle Book story doesn't sound like what we want to do. But we went ahead and did it, and for another company. And instead of 8 pages, since I was doing the adaptation, we had about 26 pages to do it. You could really let the story breathe. Well, we sold it to Eclipse Comics. And when the editor at Epic saw it, he said, well, we could have done this. So I have better luck with just doing a thing and showing it than trying to sell the idea. Anyway, I did three long Jungle Book stories. And then Neil Gaiman wrote the Graveyard Book, which is his take on the Jungle Book stories. And when he was living in London, he lived very near Highgate Cemetery, and he would take his little boy there, just to play in the stroller and such. And that's when he conceived the idea of doing the Jungle Book. And the boy, after the family is murdered, toddles up into the cemetery, and all of the ghosts make the decision that they will raise him, because sometimes it takes a graveyard. And so there are 8 stories in the Graveyard Book, and they correspond to the Jungle Book story. So I was back into the Jungle Book again. This is the first page of my chapter. What I had to do was script and lay out the entire book. It's 352 pages. And I did all the stories, and one of the reasons to do that, Neil trusts me with his original stories. He doesn't have to script it. I can script it, and I know how to turn it into a visual structure. So that's what I did. And then since HarperCollins wanted this not like 6 years from now, but after a couple years, then I found other artists to work over my layouts. It's like drawing a blueprint of a building, and there it is. And then the other artists would do finished chapters. So I picked the second chapter to do, and that's the cover for the second volume that just came out about a week ago.
He's also done a number of works of Oscar Wilde, the fairy tale series, not yet complete, but on their way to...
One to go.
Again, wonderful art. It took some time for publishers to understand that you could do a version of children's literature in a comic book.
Well, years ago, when Terry Nantier is the publisher, NBM, a company out of in New York City, and when my first one came out around 1993 or so, he could not get it into the children's book sections in bookstores. They would look at it and say, well, this is a comic book. We don't do comic books. They had illustrated children's books. That has completely changed, and a lot of children's books are now done maybe a little more simply than this sometimes, you know, 2 or 3 pictures, but it's very acceptable now. But it took a while to get it in. There are 9 of these fairy tales. I've done 8 in 5 volumes, and there's one to go. I've been working on it now for almost 25 years. Sometimes it takes a while with all the other projects.
And then, of course, there's the opera projects, and that's where we've been involved with. And yes, indeed, he has done The Ring. This is more recent than his earlier examples, but it is sumptuous and detailed, and that great elegant story quality that all runs through working the panels without word balloons, because you don't need them. The magic flute, the clowns. Notice that nice panel there, the change where you have the laughter, the clown, and the sudden realization that things aren't just so right. And of course, our last endeavor, our collaboration here, Pelias and Melisande, that we've talked a bit about, the love story involved, and the tragedy here, and of course, the issue of the gaze, of being forced to look or to try and see something, and here in one of the kind of climactic parts of that drama, and opera, and here of trying to see, to look in. And of course, that gaze, as we've talked about that, has been coming in a lot today with Oscar Wilde.
I think it was just yesterday, I had a real Emily Latella moment, you know, from Saturday, Gilda Radner. We were standing around, and he said, I want to talk about the gays and Pelias and Melisande. I thought, these are two heterosexual men in love with one woman. There are no gays in Pelias and Melisande.
And then I spelled it G-A-Z-E. We got it right. Okay. And then this is the original comic that you've had a chance to see over there. 1986, right?
I think it was. Close enough, yes.
Eclipse.
86. Yes.
Yeah. And we still have that masterpiece here that we've given to the library. And then, of course, it came out in the graphic novel form, bigger pages, better color, much more sumptuous. But at the time, this was a great breakthrough. I love it up there. It says micro series number one of one.
Yes.
You know, it's like, because that was, we had to, at that time, you had to have your series. And
right.
Well, he got it right there. But I, a little aside, that wasn't the first Salomé in comics. The first Salomé that I know of in comic books appeared in Venus number 11, 1950. Now, Venus is the goddess of love and beauty who comes down from the planet Venus to experience human love. And in number 11, at the end of the world, there is a well-meaning scientist whose experiment goes awry and hurtles the Earth towards the sun. It's going to crash. But he's so despondent because he loves this beautiful woman who is icy cold and will have nothing to do with him. So he despairs. And Venus is like, oh my God, the world's going to end. So she goes to him and says, you know, but you do have the love of your secretary. Now, the secretary happens to wear glasses. Her hair is in a bun. She is very demure. And he is like, so Venus then, because she's a goddess, conjures up three great beauties of the past, Cleopatra, Helen of Troy, and Salome, to talk to the secretary about love and beauty. This leads to a radical transformation. The scientist comes in. He sees his beautiful secretary with all of her allure, quickly fix his experiments, and the world is saved. So there is our first example. We haven't had this
Somebody's
one.
Lost their glasses. Yeah. That's
right. That's right. Yeah. But Marvel Comics. This is a... I don't have that. A lot of times that was...
They didn't give credits back
They
then.
Didn't give
Very
credits.
Rarely.
Yeah. I've tried to... I don't have this comic yet, but it's in I'm in the queue. Then we had the graphic novel version, 2004, I believe it was, that came out. And of course, we start with that gaze that so many of you saw, the kind of, and here, Craig, so effectively letting you know through the word balloon what he's thinking, right? And then the thought balloon, it's rather clear. But it comes with this whole notion, again, you know, the gaze sometimes is, with G-A-Z-E, is too much with us. Oftentimes in theory and elsewhere, but let's face it, Oscar Wilde saw it first, and he's explicit. And here I've combined several panels from different pages about something terrible will happen. Why do you look at her? She's like a dove that has strayed, and later he will commit suicide. Right? I mean, this is what happens from sight. And then, of course, this is a set of panels that reflect the gaze. Why don't you go ahead and give us the commentary on this?
Well, this is what sort of happens when you're listening to the music, constantly listening to Strauss's interpretation of Wilde or his dramatization of Wilde. So in a sense, I was at times doing an adaptation of an adaptation. I started with his libretto, which cut the play almost in half, and then went back and put in a couple little things. But at this point, the only dialogue, "It must be terrible to be in so black a hole. It is like a tomb. Did you not hear me? Bring out the prophet." If you were watching this on stage, that's what you would have, because the image is there. You're not being cinematic at all. In the opera, when she says that and goes on the stage to look into the cistern, the sound just gets black. It just drops out from underneath you, and this dark sound. And that's what told me to go there, look into the abyss as she's looking, and then you just have the black panel. And then we reverse the sight as if we are John the Baptist in there looking out and up at her.
And this cistern becomes the visual leitmotif, really, of perhaps their relationship, but certainly of Solomon.
Well, you're constantly looking from one side or the other of those bars, but also from a distance you see it is a spiral, as if you're going down a drain. And at the end, when Salome is looking at the head in one of those last panels, the earth actually drops out from underneath her. Her feet are hanging, and it is this swirling effect again. Again, to try to get that feeling from the music, you know, that's so ecstatic, and you try to find some sort of visual equivalent.
And when you see here, he's working in the horizontal, with the vertical, but going across, and then here we're going from up top to bottom.
And we talk about the gaze, and everyone is, the page is telling Naraboth, do not look at her. And then when Herod and Herodias come in and she says, do not look at her, you're always looking at her. But it's Salome, the one who is gazing the most of all. I mean, she looks at him and then describes him up and down. And at one point, when she finally has the head, she says, why would you not look at me? So that's why, and again, the cue from the music as he's about to come up, you know, just is welling and welling up. So I wanted us going in as close as we could, and narrowing as you go in, the panels narrow and widen out so that all you see are her eyes as she's about to look on him for the first time.
And then you see that. The voice that has been coming out and that Craig has been drawing without seeing it in other panels, then it's there.
That's the fun with working with lettering. I mean, I did not letter this, but I'm designing it, you know, and with sort of a jagged thing, and I tell the letterer, this is what I want. But as you saw yesterday, his voice has been all through this as just a disembodied voice, and so you want the lettering to, you have the ability to play with that and have the lettering be very expressive.
And then we come to where he rejects her, and again, it's this whole idea of gazing. Salome, I will not look at thee, thou art accursed. So there, and then here's the reversal. So in earlier in the comic, and these are separated by quite a distance here, because this is after she's praised him and he rejects her, and this is the final rejection, and then so we are going back down into the cistern. And it comes down, and then, of course, there's the eye with the cistern. And here's Craig, where he's shifting it. Here's the shift that's happened in Salome now. This is where the love is changing into kind of an obsession of a different sort.
Yeah, this is the breaking point, where it's the tragedy of Salome, because up to this point, she is the only, and this is my take on it, but I think this was Wilde and Strauss's, the only sort of uncorrupted, undecadent, unspoiled character in the play, as opposed to a lot of the visualizations you see by other artists that has her really decadent from the very beginning as a broken, neurotic person. But she was totally untouched by this court of chaos and decadence. She's worshiping the chaste moon, this little silver disc up in the air, and refuses to be touched by any of this, even enumerating all their failures and how awful they are, and the line I love, "Ah, how I loathe the Romans." So she is, in a sense, she is completely integrated between mind and body. So that when she hears this voice of purity and idealism coming out of this cistern, she responds to that. And so when she sees him for the first time, she is her body, as she's sexually responsive to what her mind holds as the highest, purest ideal. So she is completely integrated personality. And she then approaches this object of her adoration, and it absolutely rejects her on that same, he has an absolute split between his mind and body from the very beginning. He sees any sort of a sensual love as corrupt and evil. And so he totally rejects this advance made on a love of purity and beauty. And it's at that point when it becomes clear that he has totally rejected her on a mind-body split, that she looks, and you see the cistern right there, that's when she has her break. And she takes what he has projected onto her and literally then projects it onto him. She projects onto him a mind-body break that he has projected onto her, and she does it in a literal way. And I think it's at this point, and that's why I did this enormous, almost surreal eye at this point. That's the breaking point. And the first thing you see after that is she's standing on the very edge, just like on the lip of the abyss. And he says, "Where is Salome?"
And this forms the split in the opera where we're going to have the intermission, so that you've had the whole, now she's descending into, well, she's going to react in the only way she knows, I suppose, in her milieu. And then this will begin the next, where she comes back to the court, and then...
Well, there are a number of sort of visual rhymes or, you know, structures where you start at one place like this in the beginning, and after this whole scene, you come back to propel yourself into the next. Or with this scene, the whole Salome John the Baptist scene begins with the cistern thing going up, and now you're going finished, down. It goes back yeah. down again.
Yeah.
And, you know, so I think of these as visual leitmotifs.
Yep.
Oh, yeah. The yeah. spiral of the sewer. Yeah.
And then, of course,
yeah.
One thing I was, but I spent a lot of time with this conflict that I was telling you, working on this project with these two. And the thing I was struck by last night, maybe because they were larger than life, or it's the pacing that happens with the music, there are a lot of nearly naked men in the first half. Mm-hmm. And Salome is always clothed, but there's a lot of beefcake in the first half.
Oh, yeah.
And it was so much more obvious to me last night. It's not like I hadn't seen it, but right. I guess it's the pacing maybe. Is
well, 40-foot screen.
Well, that helps. But it's so much, and I was thinking about that, and it's what you're saying about the gaze, about how that gets actually...
Well, yes, because, well, if you take, I mean, her description of John to his face is so highly charged and so erotic that, I mean, he is the beauty object in this, at least from her point of view. Everyone else talks about looking at Salome, but especially since she's doing the Dance of the Seven Veils and is going to end up naked, I wanted her as pretty much clothed as possible, so that with the unclothing, it's a big deal. It's a shock.
But all the soldiers are
yeah.
almost naked?
Well, yeah, that's me.
I like the contrast. It was very effective.
And then we have the dance. So again, we did what a lot of
the dance has a different person who does it, so to speak.
Right.
Where
yeah.
they where we had a real dancer as with Leanne Rinelli, but we mixed in all of these things at one point or another, but Craig does it in 3 pages.
Well, the challenge for something like this is that it, and this is what I like about adapting either anything, or especially opera, a musical form, to a silent form, are those challenges that you think, well, that can't be done. in this form, and this was a dance. And you just don't want to draw somebody dancing any more than you want to draw somebody singing with little musical notes around the word balloon. So it, I read the description, Strauss's description, right, of all the steps she goes through, you know, a few dainty steps forward and back. And so all we used is, you know, I'm ready, Tetrarch. It's basically three pages of silence. I'm ready, Tetrarch, and then the very last wonderful, wonderful thing. So you see her advancing. But I used the veils. I decided to go for a contrast as she's taking off the veil so that each one means something. The one towards Herod and falls at his feet, another one that goes up in the air, and to play with the other events going on. So when she throws this one up in the air, that's at the moment they are lifting Naboth, the soldiers. And she spins around again, and you see part of it is coming down into her panel here, and then it goes down into this panel. You see her dancing up there, and they're carrying the body away. Also playing with the color, so all of her scenes are hot. When you go to these other ones, to make it clear, this differentiation of scenes goes into very cool colors. So as they're carrying them off, she throws another one to Herod. He's holding it. She dances in the blood, walks through the blood, throws another one over, and that's the point where they throw the body over the side, over the wall. And as instead of seeing that heavy body fall, we just see a very light veil falling into the blood. Picks up here as she goes through, throws another veil, and you have the contrast of the delicate veil on the executioner's sword. Finally, one more time around the cistern, throws it up towards that symbol of the moon again. And one last time, she notices where she is, turns, looks, and throws this last veil off. And this could be seen as, you know, this one, a defiant look towards John, like, see what you're missing? Or the fact that she has completely lost it now. And that's why I tried to, what to do with the moon. The moon is constantly going through these changes. She's like a drunken woman reeling through the skies, or she's a chaste little silver disc. And at this one, with the lines radiating around it, it feels anxious at that point. And that's when she drops the veil, and it actually goes into the cistern. And then she runs and throws herself at the feet of... I liked what you did in the dance when she threw the veil over Herod and Herodias. It's one of those things you look at another artist and think, I should have thought of that. They're very nice.
And then, of course, there's the sequence that comes after she demands the head and the ring going out and the descent of the execution.
I wanted, when we were looking at the... Grace was showing the pictures, the much older pictures, paintings, that would have the beheading of John the Baptist. The whole scene would be shown as, one picture plane. We're looking at this inside of a room, and all of these events are going on. But several events in time are going on within the same continuous picture plane. John is being beheaded in this alcove, but the alcove is part of the whole scene, but the side of the alcove or the pillar almost acts like a gutter between two panels in a comic strip. You know, it says that this is going on here, and then over here there's something else is going on. So they use these devices, and it was way back then, not in the 19th century that you ever see this, but like in the 16th century, and there were a couple of them like that. And this is a fairly standard formatting comics now, where you have one continuous scene, but you divide it into panels, and you see a character traveling through that landscape.
Now, one of the things that I wanted to point out is some of the earlier depictions of this. This is by John Vasso, someone that often isn't well known, but who I think is one of my favorite Salome artists and illustrators of the book, where he combines the cistern cover, Salome, the executioner, and then John there at the bottom in a kind of this Art Nouveau swirl. And I think Vasos is making this connection there in the 20s with a little psychoanalysis about sex and death that we'll see kind of run through his work. And yet that contrast from, here it is. Here's part of his, here's the decapitation and her just kind of, ooh, she's excited. Look at that head, you know? And it's, again, this, she's already kind of like a vampire here when you're looking at the eyes. And I think it's a wonderful drawing, but it contrasts quite a bit with this. You know, and here we have the arm coming up and the movement towards her madness.
Well, the challenge was something like this, and again, working with the music, where it's so overpowering that on the stage, something very simple is happening. These people, human beings in costume, someone is coming out of a cistern, and they've got that. But it's the music that gives it this overwhelming power. So I had to do something more symbolic. On the previous page, they're turning, and you see her as everyone is sort of reacting. And so it becomes much more of a symbolic panel rather than realism, because the arm is behind her, nothing is that big, and it's all in silhouette. But it gives you something, attempts to give a feeling of the overpowering
And
moment.
She hovers over the cistern. This comes back.
Yeah, oh, that, right.
This comes back. And then we have what we've talked about, the kiss. We have with Beardsley's grotesque, misogynist, I would say, not only decadent drawings. And then we can, which we Grace has already talked about, and then we can contrast it with this. This is what we were talking about. And again, Craig has done something quite nice here. This is the most realistic panel, I would say, in the entire comic. That it's the detail, he has enlarged the picture, he's brought it down, and then with the dialogue, it's just really amazing, where in a sense, I guess you might want to say, this is her salvation in a strange way.
Well, I'd also like to say what they did in putting this together, that Chris and Matthew working this out, as you saw, coming in close to that and then fading into that blue color shows you something that I'm really excited in working on future projects with, that you can do to bring something else to this graphically that is so effective.
And then we begin the descent into madness, which you, again, last night was so well done. And the with the combinations of her eyes, the moon, and then the full on that, the final panel on the right, there again, she's hovering over an abyss with the head.
Well, yeah, at this point, I wanted the feeling that the earth has simply dropped out from underneath her at this point, and she's already going down this spiral, as we'll see, you know, in the very last panel. The fun of working this out was that, you know, 98% of this was done when I got here, but they asked me about these final pages, which were still rough, and working with next to Chris, who knows computers and everything you can do, you know, I came up with a suggestion of, you know, let's pan all the way up this to the moon. They had the moon there already, but we needed more movement in this to go with the music, so that panning up, and then as soon as you do that, it connects to the next panel, and you pan down. Just the subtleties, the fun of playing with this, he had come up and went down. And I said, well, when you get up there at the top, just stop, take a breath, and then start down again. Just that sort of pacing, that when you see it there, you really don't know until you've got that raw material and you look at what it looks like. Watching it last night afterwards, I went up to Chris and I said, well, if we're going to do this, let's put these panels over here. So there'll be some changes in Friday night of things that just present themselves to you when you watch it.
And notice how he's used his word balloons going up and stopping right in the middle, but what of that? And then moving down, this wonderful use of the...
Which gave them all kinds of trouble, because these word balloons go across all three panels. Now, how do you isolate them? How do you deal with that problem?
You have the additional problem that these are vertical panels in the comic book, and you have a landscape shape screen. Mm-hmm. And so the eye pictures are much easier for us because they're
right. Yeah, but with the scrolling, I think that makes, you know, you have possibilities with this for movement, where instead of having just a static image one after the other, suddenly you have movement here, and you get those if you have these vertical things. You have those opportunities.
And it does take time to look at these images.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Just another contrast. I show the sophistication, I would say, of our newer version. And then here's one thing that... that Joy and I have worked with in the article that we did with Matthew is that the one place in Beardsley that Salome looks feminine is when she's dead. And she's being put into a rouge pot. And that's the end of it. It's kind of, oh, that how funny. Vasos is a little more sophisticated. And again, I would say we're looking at Freud's Love and Death or Sex and Death. But then we get here. This is the last page. And again, Craig Russell is just coming down. As you know, the opera ends fast. When it starts, it goes. And it's kill that woman.
And this syncs up with the music in that wide fourth panel. That's when all of that da-da-da-da-da is going on. And then there's a pause and da-da-dum again. So I had a pause. And then the final. But when we were looking at this on the screen, if you end with that final thud thud, then this feels too quiet, and you still need a little bit of music behind that. So there were enough da da dums and thuds in there that we could still have them sync up, and then have music with that last one, and then go to a fade
as they go down the drain. I mean, there's that image yet again.
He's got a great face to draw. I've used him. Yeah. He was Mima in the Ring of the Nibelung and all kinds of characters.
Craig draws from live models, many cases. And then, but he hasn't finished. I mean, he's done some other art since then of Salome, and you can't help but understand where this one came from. And when we were talking about this, he told me this was his first visual. Or
what I think, the Moreau paintings of Salome. I mean, he did several. It wasn't this particular one, but it was one of the dancing Salomes.
Yeah, so we have a more recent drawing. And so one of the things I would point out, I mean, if you're not a big comic book reader like I am, you wouldn't have thought about it very much, but Marvel Comics, DC Comics, Image Comics, I mean, the women in these comics, or the men too, are just, like Playboy, right? I mean, it's all gratuitous. And Craig is very careful about that. I mean, we have a real person that's working through here that he's been very careful with. So, but it's like, what would the Marvel version look like? That. There she is, Salome. She appeared once in the Uncanny X-Men. She's part of the Hellfire Club of San Francisco. And on the Marvel scene, it says, what's her status? Bad and dead. Okay, and of course she wants them snuffed, but in a way, there's one thing that they could, or that the two Salomés are alike is, they know what they want. Thank you.
Well.
Friday, 8 o'clock. Do you have any questions?
So my question is sort of a loaded one. I just. Last night's performance was fascinating, but I also felt like it could go further. And I wondered whether you had the same thought, that if you had a pile of money, whether you could go from the book form to to a live form, whether you would expand, what you might do.
Well,
somebody just said, continue.
Well, when I was watching it last night, like I was saying, when you see that sort of the final cut and you can see it in toto, I had several ideas as, you know, what we could do, and one we're, you know, incorporating into tomorrow night's. There's one where Salome has an empty word balloon where John has given this big speech. You know, she said, I want to kiss your mouth, and he gives a big speech. And she just looks at him like she hasn't heard a thing. And then she says, let me kiss thy mouth. And he's just like, haven't you heard a thing I've said? But she has this little empty word balloon, which in the quickness of the panel progression when you're reading the book has better timing. You understand that what this little empty word balloon means. Now I look at that and I say, well, we could get the same effect if we went into the white of that balloon and the white just filled the screen. That would just say emptiness and then go back and him looking shocked. So I don't think we would need a lot more money, given that, you know, the nature of what we're doing is rather simple. You can refine and a lot. You know, I look at it, you know, it's kind of terrifying to see your own work blown up this size. These pictures, you know, a panel is like this big. And it looks very finely detailed at that, you know, size. You grow it and expand it, and it takes on a whole different calligraphic thing, and sometimes it falls apart a little bit. There are places in there, of course, you know, you look at your own work and you see things you'd like to work on.
Sometimes color strays with the dots.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
So there's a few panels that they look like they have smallpox.
Well, yeah, this was a color... This was my original coloring. This is before a computer. And they were done on photostats, so like photographic paper. You try putting watercolor on photographic paper, it's almost impossible. But then you had a black line overlay on acetate, so almost like doing an animation cell. So to counter the streakiness of coloring on that sort of glossy paper, I would take large sheets of Frisket paper. Frisket is what you use in airbrush. You cover the whole thing, you cut out the part you want to airbrush, and it covers everything else up. It's sticky on one side. Well, we would take airbrush and color the Frisket paper itself. And then for a night scene, use it almost like a filter in a camera, like a blue filter for nighttime. So you do this sort of coloring underneath and then put a blue filter over it, and suddenly it's night. And you have a smoothness to the color. It covers up all sorts of problems. Well, the one with the speckles was one I had done, and I liked this texture it gave. But when you look at it blown up on the faces, they've got these little red dots, and I would like to go in and just, you could actually take a pencil eraser and erase this color on the Frisket, because the Frisket doesn't absorb the color either. And you can just erase color so that you let color from underneath come out for these different, it was a really marvelous way to work, but way time consuming. Everything had to be cut out around with an X-Acto knife. All these faces, even little fingers, so when you blow it up, you see these things being a little bit off because you've got the color plate and the black and white, and then the precision of doing that. So that's one of those things that doesn't quite translate from this. Now, if we do ever do things later where we're doing it on computer, from the computer coloring, I mean, the precision is amazing.
Yeah. I'm sorry.
I was going to say, the musical analog to that, too, is that I think one of the reasons why we use a chamber ensemble version is because you also strip down all the colors in a very similar kind of way. And so, in a way, we face the same problem that you do, blowing up an orchestra score to eight people. Mm-hmm. That presents a lot of problems, too, in the way you score it, and the kinds of parts they have to play. I mean, it's one thing to have 12 violins playing that part. It's a completely different strain to expect one guy to do it for 2 hours, even if it was the same part.
Yeah.
There's no one to help you out.
Yeah,
you know?
And as close as I follow, and this has been a blessing for doing these sorts of adaptations, I pretty much followed the original libretto straight through. So the music lines up with the action and the panels. But there are places where the music takes longer to make a point, and we have one picture, and that gives us, you know, the problem of, do you just show that picture? Do you come in on it? Is there something else you can do to sort of fill up this time and make it still feel full, you know?
Or like the Dance of the Seven Veils, where we have three pages versus 9 minutes.
Nine minutes. So I thought that was a great stroke to bring in a live dancer.
Yeah. There's another one we do where Craig has added something from the play that wasn't in the opera. So we got a bunch of geek composers, so we wrote Strauss. I mean, no one spotted what we wrote. We wrote a big chunk of the music.
I have a question about the interpretation of Salomé herself.
Yes.
Because I completely agree, this semester working on this opera and graphic novel, I have seen the heartbreak of that story in a way I never did before. But the only part I still wonder about is the triangle between Salomé,
Salome and Maribov and the young Syrian. It seems to me as if she manipulates the page of Herodias, rather, but she manipulates Maribov in his death.
Oh, yeah.
Before she ever sees John, before John ever rejects her, what do you make of that?
Well, that's a good point, because she obviously, I paint her as this sort of still very innocent and chaste, but she has that in her personality from the beginning too. None of us is perfectly, this idealized version. But she is. She wants this, and once she has something that she wants, she's willing to start working it, and she knows she can work this person. You know, I will look at you from the litter and all of this, and she's using that gaze. She's promising to look at him, and is completely oblivious to when he falls at her feet. She claims not to be a part of this decadence at all, but once she's got her eye on something, and she is her mother's daughter. You know, she still seems to have. She hates the stepfather, but her mother she's still close to, and so that is. She hasn't quite developed into that yet, but you can see the seeds of it.
How did you arrange to have a real blood red moon on the same night that you
had a whole planning, Lawrence?
That's the part about being with the religion department. Yeah.
We got a grant.
Yes?
I just wondered if you could say a few words about if your artistic vision changed with the computer and its changed technique.
I would say a simple answer, no. It's widened things. For example, when Herod is saying, you know, shut out the moon and the stars and the cloud comes up, or any of those shots of the sky with clouds when he says you hear the beating of its wings and all that, you still have that black ink line around the clouds because I had to draw the original artwork like that. Now on computer, everything I've done in the last 20 years, there's never a black line around a cloud. I've drawn it like that, but I tell Lovern, my colorist, okay, that will be a dark blue line or something. You can do color holds like I showed with the Oni and the Tengu. And I'm thinking about that when I'm drawing it, of what can recede. And I try not to go too far. There are people with computer coloring that they want to use every bell and whistle and all the airbrush and glitz and all this. I try to go no farther than you would see on a Japanese woodblock print of 18th or 19th century. Some airbrush gradations, some color holds and such, but to keep it fairly graphic and simple. But I really do take advantage of any landscape in the distance will be a color hold. It just gives you a layer of depth and atmosphere. And that's about as far as I take it.
Can I add something about, just about, for us, the computer is indispensable because the dance is shot as video, and that creates one set of problems to line it up because the musicians have to follow that. But the rest of the show, we're triggering everything live, so that means the musicians just play. They don't even think about what, and that's quite different from a normal opera where the musicians, first of all, you hit, you won't see them. And furthermore, they're always following the singer because the conductor's following the singer. So one of the joy of me thinking about the liberation of the singer, removal of her and what it does. But after I thought about that more, it's actually the liberation of the musicians because you actually see them on stage.
Because the only thing that works like that today in opera is the person running the supertitles.
The supertitles is they're not connected to the people particularly.
No.
You see a conversation with Craig, and you can get to see, that's two different people. They're saying that. It's actually easier to read as a comic book, I think, than super comic.
But I think for Chris, it's probably the most hair-raising of more so than the magicians or musicians or conductor or anything, because he has this deck of pictures, one after another, one string after another. And working with Matthew with the score takes two people over here just to work with the conductor and keep those in line.
If you have other questions, can we do this informally, because we've got some folks in that have to take the tech down and kind of run over our limit.
All right.
So thank you very much. Tomorrow.